All right, everybody. We're gonna go ahead and get started. I'll let y'all sit down. So just a few notes. First of all, I'm Joseph Basick. Welcome, everybody. It's been a few years, but we finally made it happen, so hooray for that. I want to go over a few things. Clearly, this is a bit weird for us. We're on a Zoom call right now, so we have remote attendees for the very first time ever, I think, for this conference. For anybody that's presenting in this room, stay right here. This is where the camera's pointed. This is where the microphones are. So if you wander down the stage, the people in the Zoom call are just not going to hear or see anything. The microphones are on the table. Please use them. We have this every year, but this year it's particularly important because, again, people on the call will not be able to hear you if you're just yelling at each other. The other fun thing is that this is being recorded and will be put up on the YouTube for Linux Foundation, so people like me need to watch your mouth. So. This will be a very fun 3 days of seeing how long it takes me to start swearing into this thing. Other than that, I think everybody has everything. The schedule, I've gotten a lot of questions about. It was in the email. It's on the website. If you go to the website, you click on schedule. You can see the schedule. It should take you to a Google Sheets, which will be changing constantly as we move things around. It has all of the Zoom links. So if you have to like bug out and watch from your room or whatever, you can click on that. The Zoom password was sent to your email for both in-person and virtual attendees. If you can't find it, you don't know it, find somebody on the program committee. That is me, Omar right here. I don't have my glasses, I can't see anybody else. Why don't the program committee stand up so you know who you are. So I got McCall, got Dan Williams back there. Alexi's around here somewhere. Those are Mir, Alexi, Daniel. So these are your program committee members. Thank them profusely because they've been doing this for 3 years. We've been trying to do this for 3 years. These guys we've not rotated. So we've been doing it for this long. We are done. Maybe they're not, but I'm for fuck sure done. So.
Yes!
God damn it. Anyway, so yeah, this has been a long time coming. I am super excited to see everybody here. I am super happy that everybody has managed to stay safe and relatively healthy. That is awesome to hear. Also, Martin unfortunately had an emergency. He is hopefully on the Zoom call, but he's okay. But he's obviously not here this week, but he'll be on the Zoom call. Other than that, let's get started. I think BPF is in their own room, so BPF guys can leave if they want. And Willie, you want to come talk about folios?
All right. Thanks, Joseph. All right. I wasn't expecting this to be up on YouTube, but oh well. So. I was originally planning on skipping straight to the future work slide. These are actually the slides I'm going to be using in Austin in 3 months' time. But I'm not going to do the talk that I'm doing there. I'm just going to skip around and use this to illustrate to primarily file system people, I think, are my audience for this bit, because file system people don't know about memory management. And I asked a file system person earlier today about compound pages, and they said, is that like a compound fracture? Yes, multiple things are going wrong all at the same time. They are exactly like that. but yeah, seriously, this is what a... When you say to the VM, hey, give me a compound page of order 3, this is what it looks like. It allocates 8 consecutive pages. And each of the last 7 pages all point back to the first one and say, hey, that's where all the real information is that you need to know. And so when you call something like lock page on a tail page, it actually locks the head page. And then you start asking questions about things like, well, okay, so is this page up to date? And it doesn't actually know the up-to-date status of each individual page. It actually knows the status of the entire order three blob, the compound page. And so you can already hear I'm having trouble talking because I'm using page to mean two very different things, right? There's page size bytes, which is, you know, 4K or 8K, whatever. And then there's the size of this, whatever this page happens to be. And so because I'm having trouble talking about it, that means that we need a new term. So this is why I came up with folio, right? Anyway, I kind of skipped over the, like, why are we doing this? We're doing this because we really want to be able to manage memory in larger chunks than 4K, right? On your laptop right now, you've got, what, 16 gig, 32 gig? Right, that is millions of pages. That's millions of 4 kilobyte pages. It is a pain. See, Joseph, that's how you don't swear on YouTube. It's a real pain to deal with that many pages. We really need to manage memory in larger chunks. We are wasting so much time. We're wasting so much energy just trying to understand, oh, you know, I'm moving all these pages around onto these lists and that list, and it's stupid. We just need to manage memory in larger chunks. But in order to do that, we need better infrastructure. We need the folio. So this is, I'm just kind of talking about some of our bad interfaces, right? But fundamentally, if you see something that takes a struct page, you don't know what happens if you pass the tail page of a compound page to it, or you pass a head page of a compound page. We have all kinds of functions that do all kinds of crazy things, and you know, you start asking around, well, what is this supposed to do? And chances are nobody actually thought, well, what if this is a compound page? Because for so long, file systems have been dealing with order zero pages. There haven't been, other than for TempFS, there has just not been the case that file systems see compound pages. File systems have always seen order zero pages. So, we have a new type, struct folio. And a folio refers to the head. It is essentially an alias for the head page. So if you see a struct folio, you know you are talking about the head page of it. So you don't need to say, oh, is this a tail page? If it's a tail page, go and get the head page. You just forget all about that. You just use the folio interfaces that exist. And they do now mostly exist. I've been kind of dribbling them into the tree over the last few kernel releases. And I won't say we have complete coverage yet, but certainly as I go and convert more and more code to use folios instead of pages, there's less and less places that I have to convert first. I can generally go to any given file system and convert a function using a struct page, using struct folio, and all the interfaces that I need already exist. This is kind of a timeline of when stuff went upstream. I should probably do a 5.19 with all the stuff that's currently sitting in Next. I'm not going to talk about when, well, maybe I should. So we decide, right now large folios are only allocated during read ahead. We don't yet do it in the write path. So if you are writing to a part of file that you have previously read, the read ahead will already have created large folios or may have created large folios, and it will see the opportunity to use the folios which were already in the page cache. But if you're writing to, if you're appending to a file, or if you're writing to a part of the file which happens to not be cached right now, then it will create order zero pages. And we need to go through and figure out, okay, so what criteria should we use to start creating large pages in the write path? So this is really what I wanted to talk to this audience about. Where do we go from here? So some things are obvious, like there are large chunks of the MM which don't use folios today, and should. file systems. What I really want from file systems is that they take a look around and see what they could not write themselves. That is, there's Dave Howells has done a huge amount of really important work creating common code for network file systems. It was done in aid of making CacheFS work better, but it's really created a common layer that any network-based file system can use. And even some file systems which aren't technically network file systems, like I think Fuse can use it, and maybe a couple of other file systems can also use it. It's really pretty neat, and it's worth looking at. But a lot of the inspiration that we took from in order to create the NetFS layer actually came from IOMAP. It's not a perfect replication, but a lot of the inspiration for it came from IOMAP. And what I'd really like to see is more file systems moving away from using buffer heads and towards IOMAP. That's for block-based file systems, of course. It just makes everything better. It really does. It would technically be possible to create, to convert all of the buffer head stuff from using pages to using folios. And we're probably going to do that anyway. I've made a start on that. Some of the patches for doing that are in 5.19, or will be in 5.19. But there's some code paths like making things up to date and making things dirty that are actually O n squared in the number of buffer heads on a page. And that's manageable when you're talking about 512 byte blocks on a 4K page, because you've got 8 of them, so that's an order of 64. But when you're talking about, oh, I've got a 2 megabyte page, and I've got 1 kilobyte blocks, and all of a sudden you're talking about orders of millions, you know, that, and it's a linked list walk as well, right? So, you know, approximately you've pessimized for a modern CPU. People need to move away from buffer head. Those same kind of operations, by the way, are a bitmap scan in IOMAP, right? So you've got 1 bit per block, and so, you know, that's clearly that's clearly cheaper for a CPU to do than trying to walk a linked list.
Do you want to take comments now or afterwards?
Sure, yeah.
Sure. So you've already talked to the EXT4 community a bit about this subject, and I was wondering maybe it'd be useful to maybe go into some of the discussions we had over how to actually convert to IOMAP, as in, you know, read path only or the happy, easy cases first, because switching to IOMAP as a file system developer can seem rather daunting. Going to IOMAP can be an incremental process, and maybe that's worth a bit of discussion now, perhaps?
I think a bit of discussion now is a fine idea, Ted. Do you want me to kick that off, or do you want to kick it off?
Sure, why don't you kick it off? I could do it, but I would be repeating what you told me, so.
Well, that's fair. All right, so, right, as Ted said, he and I have had discussions, and not just he and I, of course, Jan and others as well. So IOMAP is currently missing some features that other file systems like EXT4 have, right? There's FS Verity, a few other things. So the easy start to this is to say, okay, we'll define one set of address-based operations for the easy cases where those optional features aren't enabled, and then we'll have our current, you know, we'll keep our current buffer head ones around for that. And it's not too dissimilar to how EXT2 had the no BH mount option, except it wouldn't be an explicit mount option. It would be like, okay, we're going to choose the right path for, we're going to choose the fast path for you. And so if you didn't enable things like FS Verity or what are the other features IOMAP doesn't have yet?
FS Script, FS Verity. I think compression tends to be handled by individual file systems. I think the other thing that's probably worth mentioning here is that at least at the moment, a lot of the value add for folios is on the read path because of the, you know, read pages being able to create large folios. And if a file system is doing something special on the write path in terms of how it handles ref links or delayed allocation that don't necessarily fit yet into how IOMAP does things, you know, there is an alternative to trying to get it into IOMAP first, is you could just simply do the read path and keep the write path in the file system specific bufferhead approach, even if what that means is on the write path, we have to break up the folio, at least on the read path, we'd be able to get the benefits of folio.
Yep, absolutely. Everything Ted said there, I agree with that. Yeah, but and to elaborate on that, obviously one of the things that does need to happen is that IOMAP needs to grow support for the things that it doesn't currently have. And that could come from any of the file systems which happen to implement that feature and it doesn't. So, you know, if ButterFS wants to do the...
So I'm working... I suppose you can hear me. Yeah. So I'm working on converting ButterFS, or at least you making ButterFS use IOMAP, and some of the problems which I faced, of course, was the way ButterFS does its writes, in the sense, the way it is written to disk. So there were hooks which were added, at least it's in the code, in my temporary code right now, which does submit IO primarily for the BIOS. So it basically pulls in the BIOS from the IOMAP and does the writes accordingly. We are doing something similar for direct writes already, and we'll have something similar for buffered reads and buffered writes as well, which would basically do all the compression or see some checks and all those stuff internally. So yeah, wait for the code to come in.
That's fantastic. Thank you. I really appreciate that you're doing that work. That's marvelous. The more of us who are doing that, the better. Good job.
Does this one work?
Yes.
There we go. So at least for ButterFS, we have this kind of like really annoying thing where we have to order the page lock before our internal file system locks because of page reclaim. I don't know if this is on your map, but I find it particularly fucking annoying. And it's like, I would love to have that addressed. And I know it's like, it's not super easy, right? Because you have to lock the page to know that it's on a mapping to then call into the file system to whatever. So like, I know it's not, hey, yeah, can we just not have it locked? But having a way to do this, so maybe we can order our file system locks above the page lock, would I think I would love, especially because our like range locking is kind of problematic. It makes it annoying because we have to do allocations to do the range locking.
Are your file system locks sleeping locks?
Say again?
Are those sleeping locks, your file system locks you're talking
about?
Yeah,
they're sleeping locks.
This was totally not on my radar. I don't use ButterFS myself, so I wasn't aware that this was a specific problem you guys had. So yeah, let's talk about that afterwards, and I'll put that into my pot of things I think about.
Yeah, perfect.
So
thanks,
Joseph.
Yeah.
Actually, are you talking about the extent locks?
Yeah.
So, technically, if you do the extent locks in IOMAP begin or when. In case of a write back during the map blocks, if you have the submit IO hook, you can do it when the end IO is called.
Right, so more what I'm concerned about is release page and invalidate page, where you call in with the page locked, and then we have to lock the range to make sure there's no IO outstanding.
Yeah, so if you have something like release pages and all, you can always use, I tracked down the release pages and invalidated pages, and it was primarily for truncate operations.
Okay.
And I've put it around that, but if there is anything else I should know about.
Yeah, I think the MM will call us like for direct reclaim, right? People want to chime in here? For like direct reclaim, they'll call in and say like, hey, chuck this page right now. and then we have to tell it, yeah, we can or no, we can't. And we have to take the lock for that. And that's outside of the truncate path. This is one of my kind of pet peeves, it's not anybody's fault, right? It's just the way it's designed is that, you know, MM wants to do something and they have to tell the file system to do it. And we don't have a real great way to handle that. And like, you have to understand the intricacies of how the system fits together. I've found this particularly problematic as I'm training new people to work on ButterFS. They're like, why does it work like this? Well, sit down. Do you have an hour? We'll explain it. Like it's a huge gotcha, and I would love to make that interface especially a lot more simple.
Yeah, I don't think these problems are specific to ButterFS. No, I think, you know, Extended 4 and Extended 3 had a lot of problems with ordered I/O versus using page cache versus using buffer heads, and a lot of that work was fixing this locking cycle. So it's all of us in different ways.
I mean, you could always take the same approach that XFS did and delete your write page operation.
Yeah, that's becoming increasingly attractive.
Yeah.
We're gonna get off on a tangent here, so stop me when you want.
Hey, I'm not supposed to be starting till 9:30, so we've still got 7 minutes of bonus time.
Perfect. So the way page reclaim happens is really kind of problematic, especially for like low pressure systems. We see this all the time with like XFS. You start to go do like XFS has the shrinking thing, and that's where they start writing pages, right? So you do like a low level, you have some memory pressure, and then it just like stalls the entire system because it decides it's going to write out some pages. Because we don't have a great interface to say like, hey, file system, maybe write some stuff back, you know, other than balanced dirty pages, right? Like I'm talking specifically for like metadata, right? There's not a really great interface for page reclaim, like just, hey, give me what you can right now, and also, hey, write back so you can reclaim, because it's all kind of based around this idea of like, the MM tells us we want this page specifically right now, and maybe we could rethink that to like, not I want this page right now, but I want you to do something and make that path a little bit more nebulous or less gotcha-y for file systems.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, this sort of part of the MM is something that I'm very much still learning, because it wasn't important to me until just recently. And then I started trying to convert it to use folios, and it was kind of like, hang on a minute, why are we doing this? Like, how much does this even still make sense anymore? I mean, I think back when we had less capable file systems, sure, it was fine,
yeah.
Right? Because we're in reclaim. Everything is going to suck anyway. And then, you know, I started talking with Dave Chinner about what XFS was doing and why XFS got rid of its write page operation. And it's like, well, competent file systems don't do that anymore. Competent file systems don't let themselves get into a situation where the MM is saying, I need this page written back right now. A competent file system will have all the spindles available to it running at maximum speed, doing giant write backs of the stuff that the file system knows makes sense to write back. And if a page happens to get to the end of the LRU and it's still dirty, the MM needs to move on and try and put that page back on the LRU somewhere and try and reclaim the next page off the LRU.
Yeah.
Because there is nothing the file system can do because the spindles are already running at full speed creating new clean pages.
Yeah, looking at it from the file system point of view, it's like not just one page because it's almost a range of pages. So whenever you write in ButterFS, you like kind of write the entire extent.
Yeah.
So if you need an information saying that, okay, this page needs to be written, it should be probably a range of pages rather than just one single page. So
from the VM's point of view, it doesn't know that. It's got an LRU and it's pulled one page, it's pulled the last page off the list and it said, oh, this one's still dirty. Go write it back for me. And I think it just needs to stop doing that. The problem is that we still have less competent file systems in the tree, right? But I suspect that for a competent file system, and the three file systems who've been speaking are all competent ones, just delete your write page operation. See what happens, right? I mean, if it blows up, I think that was also very important information. But yeah, delete your write page operation and see what happens.
Yeah, I removed it from AFS.
Yeah.
And it still seems to work. So it's not, that isn't merged upstream yet, but I've taken it out of my own tree. It still seems to work fine. 9P is a bit harder because it only has a write page operation. Some of them do. So those need converting to write pages first. But with the network file systems, I'm going to try and get rid of all of that from the file system anyway. I'm going to talk about that later.
That sounds fantastic, Dave. Good job.
It seems to me that there's multiple problems that sometimes MM is trying to solve when we talk about write page, right? There is the global memory pressure problem, right? Where I just need free memory, tell me where I can get it, and you know, I'm not particularly picky. There is the C group memory pressure where we're trying to relieve memory pressure on a particular container, right? And then we've got the compaction problem where we're trying to actually free a specific page because we're trying to reassemble a 2 gig huge page, right? And maybe we need to think about different mechanisms for those different scenarios as opposed to assuming that like one solution is gonna fix them all. And I suspect if we actually tried to, you know, explore all of those, we're gonna rat hole, so maybe now is not the time to do that, but I just want to point out that removing write page might solve the global dirty memory problem, but there are other reasons why I suspect MM might want to say, I'd like you to clean that page.
Yeah, but you could call write pages with arrange saying that page. But the difference between write pages and write page is that write page, the Vim has already locked page. And that's been proving a problem for me to try and get around you. So I'd love Willie's idea of just get rid of it.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things a lot of the more advanced file systems do is they will actually, I think we were taking write page and just implementing it in terms of write pages. And write pages would be free to write more pages than what are actually requested by the MM, which sort of addresses that problem. And then we basically dealt with the locking inversion problems frantically to deal with that particular situation.
Yeah, because
It
was one of the scenarios I've seen is I need to write the page before the one that's locked by the VM. And that has all sorts of nasty problems. If another bit of the VM is saying, oh, can you write that page? And now I've got a deadlock situation that I can't easily get around, but just getting rid of write page works for that.
I do think Ted highlighted a lot of the right ideas in terms of like peeling out exactly why the memory management subsystem wants a particular page written. Because the huge page case and the container case, those are gonna be a lot harder to solve. Where the container one, I would hope, you know, the containers are shuffling memory around and all the same optimizations we do globally tend to work as long as your containers are fairly large. But the huge page case will be different, so we should probably break it out.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I think that's good. Yeah, I did want to touch on the fragmentation compaction kind of angle to all this, which is that if we are using larger pages, then there's actually going to be a lot less of the problems that we currently have because there's it's much easier to find 16 contiguous order 5 pages than it is to find 16 contiguous order 5 pages than it is to find 512 contiguous order 0 pages. Some things are going to get a lot easier. With this, I've been some people have been sending me some interesting benchmarks that they've been doing, and I clearly they're not particularly representative workloads, but I do see reductions like by a factor of 1,000 in number of pages on the LRU list, which is just insane. so yeah, it's great to see, but it's like that's. At least twice as good as I thought the maximum was going to get. How on earth did that happen? I don't know. Maybe I just screwed up the statistics. I mean, that's been known to happen. So I already know about some of the problems that we are going to see. One is that we now only track dirtiness on a folio basis. We don't track it on an individual page. So if you have a workload that reads in 128 kilobytes, we're going to create an order five page, and then we write to one byte in it. That's going to mark that entire 128 kilobytes as dirty. And so that means we're going to see an increase in write bandwidth. But on the other hand, particularly for a copy on write file system, that will reduce the fragmentation, because all of a sudden you're writing out a 128 kilobyte blob and updating a pointer to that rather than writing out a 4 kilobyte blob. I don't think it's going to be a serious concern. I haven't seen any workloads that significantly suffer as a result, but Chris.
Yeah. I know Jens has put a lot of time into making it possible to do much smaller granularity of writes through IOU ring, specifically to resolve the memory bus utilization concerns of even writing 4K or 8K or 16K. So you might want to talk to him.
Yeah, that's mostly been on the read side. And Keith actually posted a patch here for this very recently. So I'll pass it to Keith.
Delegation, isn't it grand?
Yeah. I did post the patches, but I never saw them hit the list, so I have a configuration problem. So nobody saw them unless you were CC'd directly. So on the read side, this is a bit protocol specific if you can do subsector reads. So I'm focusing, of course, on NVMe, and that's going to it's using the bit buckets in order to do partial sector reads or straddling mm-hmm. two sectors. So this is going in the other direction of where folios of being bigger. This is going smaller. So I'm not sure if this is a good spot to talk about this, but yeah.
Yeah, but I think we want the big pages and the little IOs.
Well, do we? I mean, I don't know. Are we giving up a huge amount here by saying, well, you know, we've got this 128 kilobyte page, so that's going to absorb, it might absorb more writes into it before it gets written back. So, you know, you've got less of an opportunity to create a checkerboard pattern in your file system layout. I know, it's certainly not definitely a bad thing.
I don't disagree with you. I just know we have workloads that are massively memory bus constrained.
Yeah.
And so writing 128K when we need something very small will be significant.
Yeah.
Do we have any stats, Chris, on, I wonder even for 4K pages, right? How much do we dirty per the 4K we're writing out? Because I could easily see even medium-sized pages, right? You're going to be writing a substantial amount of data over the bus that you don't really need to.
So in ButterFS, I would have been taking Matthew's position of, just write it, who cares? So I don't know, it's going to be very workload specific, I think.
I guess the big question is if you do a kernel compile. Because I know someone who cares about that a lot.
On my laptop, the kernel time goes down by like 6 seconds for a kernel build. But the overall isn't particularly affected.
No, but it's probably a trade-off, right? So you're saving some CPU, but you're using a lot more bus bandwidth. And as Chris said, for some applications, they're bound by that currently, right? So if you add 25% extra bus bandwidth, they're going to be running 25% slower.
I don't think I am. Because think about what a kernel compile does. It does a lot of reads, but it always reads the entire file. Because, I mean, you've got to read the entire header file. And then it does writes, but writes don't create large folios because it's always writing to a new file. And it will read back what it already wrote, but so that's probably still in cache, and then it's creating a VM Linux at the end of it. I don't know, it all sounds to me very much like it shouldn't really be.
But for a kernel compile, most of the files are being created, written front to back and closed, so it really doesn't make any difference in that situation.
Yeah.
In any case, I think it'd be nice to have some statistics or metrics right for this so we know. Because for some people, it will definitely make a big Yeah. If we're overriding.
And maybe this is somewhere, another place that IOMAP needs to be enhanced. Maybe IOMAP needs to be keeping track on a sub page, a sub folio level of exactly which blocks are dirty.
Isn't it doing it already? Because I saw it writing partial bios or at least offsets and lengths.
Yeah, okay. So IOMAP does have already an optimization, which is that if you are doing a write which is aligned to and a multiple of the block size into a page which is not up to date, then it will not read the parts of the page which are not being written to. It won't do any reads. It will just say, okay, we've allocated a page, it's not up to date, but these parts of the page are dirty. And so then if that page is synced, it will do a partial page write. So that's what you've probably seen. I don't know if it's a particularly common thing for users to actually do, but it's a particularly common thing for benchmarks to do. So I think that's why the optimization's there. But that, I mean, it's software, we can change it, right? If it makes a lot of sense to actually track the dirtiness on a per block basis, even if the page is up to date, then let's do that. We should just do that. It's just right now we don't. There's probably some code to be written around if the file is mmapped and we take a page fault. If somebody just does a store, then we need to make a decision about whether we're going to make all the PTEs that cover that writable and dirty the entire thing, or whether we're going to just, you know, flip that one PTE to be writable and make that one page dirty. And that's going to have its own set of interesting trade-offs, because some CPUs, AMD have published this, it's in the AMD public documentation. It's something like 16K or 32K. If it's aligned and the PTEs are all compatible, and that includes the writable bit, then it will use a single large TLB entry instead of using a 4K TLB entry. I don't know how much that optimization is really worth. It's not something Linux has actually supported to date, and you know, I was talking to them about this because this is something that the folios now enables, rather than having to rely on pages actually just being naturally, just coincidentally in order, which actually happens more often than you might think. But you know, it's folios make it much more likely, and it certainly makes it easier to detect that we're in a situation where that could be of use. On the other hand, perhaps if somebody's doing an mmap store, we would like to only keep the dirtiness to that one page. I don't know. That sounds like something that we would need to benchmark across a wide variety of workloads and a wide variety of CPUs to figure out which optimization is worth more. But now it's a discussion we can have. Like we're in a situation where we can choose which of those optimizations we want, which is fantastic.
I think that's a great idea, by the way, this getting some metrics on it. So you have wildly different file systems, some with long latencies, some with short latencies, right? So if you're going over a network or if you have a long latency file system, you want larger IOs in parallel, right? Because the round trip cost is too expensive. So how do you measure that? Well, file systems have their own stats, NFS, SMB, all this, right? But looking at how many IOs in parallel and their average size is objective. And starting with the boring workloads, you know, your kernel compile is a good boring workload, copying a file is a good boring workload. But, you know, stepping back a lot, how would we tweak folios to kind of try different strategies? I don't know, it's probably not that easy. So maybe there's ways we could, you know, have two different patches that we could apply, or a proc setting to experiment a little bit, because I don't think we're going to get it right for a while. I mean, we'll get it better, but getting it right, because you know, had the trade-off on sending too much data versus sending data, waiting 10 milliseconds for a network round trip, sending data, waiting 10 mil, you know, that's bad, right? We have to figure out what's the best way to do this. And I guess the last question I would have on this is, some of this is confusing because we haven't all looked at MM code today. But one thing I'd really like is, are there some sample change sets, some sample patches that are examples of the boring, easy stuff that we as file system maintainers can do? Sort of like, you know, the cleanup when people went to X-Array. Like, give me an example, and then it'll be like, oh, I can do that. Because I think that some of these are just cookie cutter repetitive kinds of changes, and if we could just give some examples, that would be fantastic help.
Yeah, so to that last point, see the patches that I've been posting for the last week or two. What I've been doing for file systems is I've been converting all of the address space operations. There are two left that I need to do, which is migrate page and write page. But other than that, all the address space operations now take a folio as their first, instead of a struct page. And for most file systems, what I've done is, as the very first line is, struct page star page equals address of folio arrow page. Right. And anywhere that you see address of folio arrow page, that is a bad code smell, right? That indicates somewhere that needs to get cleaned up. And it's not that, you know, it's not the code is bad, it's just, you know, nobody's got around to cleaning this up yet. But to be absolutely clear, my intention is that every file system will be converted to using folios. It doesn't necessarily have to support large folios. It may not make sense for some file systems to support large folios, but they should all be using the folio interfaces. And the reason for that is that I am looking to get rid of that first chunk of the union of struct page. Right? So the LRU, the mapping, the index, the private, that is all scheduled to go away from struct page. And this kind of gets into something that I had very long discussions with Kent and Johannes about. You know, what is the future of struct page? Because I know the file system people aren't going to care about all this, but you're sitting here, so you're going to hear about it. From a memory management point of view, there's a whole bunch of stuff that we want to put into struct page, but keeping it at 64 bytes is incredibly important for performance right now. Like, when it starts to exceed a cache line, it gets expensive, really expensive. So what we would like to do eventually is shrink struct page. Kent says we can get it down to two words. I say we can get it down to one word. It, you know, the details aren't important, but if we can shrink struct page to just be a pointer to the struct folio, or a pointer to a bunch of other things which are currently all, you know, these various different unions, really they're their own types, and they should be treated as their own types. And the reason they're not is, of course, because it's easier just to put a you know, dump another thing onto the top of this than it is to refactor the entire world. Well, here I am refactoring the entire world. So yeah, the idea is that. Oh, come on. Yeah. So this is kind of what you need to understand. This is the high level overview of struct page, right? So. There's a per-purpose union, well, two per-purpose unions. There's a ref count, there's the flags, and there's some other gunk. And I think we can get rid of basically all of it and just have per 4 kilobytes, we have a struct page, which is just a pointer to the real data structure. And then, you know, when you go and allocate an order 3 page, instead of having 8 times 64 bytes, you have 8 times 8 bytes, right? And everything, you know, things become less special, right? And actually, you end up using a lot less memory. And that was Johannes's big point. And I hadn't really been thinking this in this direction at all because I didn't think it was relevant. But he convinced me, no, this is really important. That there are essentially giant pallets of money being set alight in parking lots every month because people have to buy extra RAM in order to provision various services. And if we can get back the 1.6% of memory that MemMap occupies, the entire world will be a better place. Or at least our employees will make more money, which, you know, perhaps that is the same thing. they'll be able to afford to send us to more conferences. Yes, that's how it benefits. What else might we work on?
One thing we'd like to get rid of is right beginning, right end, and do it properly without that.
Yeah, right beginning, right end. Okay, so those are two address space operations for the memory management people. I think the file system people all know about right beginning, right end. My impression was that right begin and right end were designed for EXT3's model, and then everyone else kind of squeezed themselves into EXT3's model. And perhaps it's time to overhaul how we do right begin and right end.
Yeah, if you're using IOMAP, it doesn't use right begin or right end. It's basically a different function call altogether, map blocks and.
Yeah. IOMAP doesn't use right begin and right end, and neither does NetFS.
Well, when I finish writing it, the NetFS lib won't use them either. So all the network file systems that use NetFS lib won't be using those anymore.
So clearly now we just need all the block file systems to move away from right begin and right end, and then we can delete them and we can shrink out the address space operations.
So right begin and right end are very much the old pass a bunch of callbacks back and forth model. And this is actually my big complaint with IOMAP is that it's a much cleaner version of that old model of we're still passing callbacks back and forth. And I'd like to nudge people to think more about how do we pass data structures back and forth. My big thing with the bio iterator rework and bio OV iter get pages is now called. Is that we can now just, from say the top of the DIO path, start by allocating a bio, pinning user pages directly to that, and then pass that down instead of calling back and forth through indirect function calls, which we want to get away from anyways because of Spectre and Meltdown.
Yeah, I'm also not a fan of exactly how IOMAP does it, but at least IOMAP is only doing it to itself, and it's not infected the entire VFS.
True.
So. Yeah, I think there are opportunities for improvement. And when I get around to converting that path to doing folios properly rather than just coping with folios, I think you'll like where I'm going with it, but I'm not quite ready to show the code. I've written this and abandoned it three times already, so the next time it will work, I'm sure.
And, you know, I think it's important to note here that, like, as a file system person, I could not give less of a shit like how the interface works, right? Like I want to focus on ButterFS and I really, really don't want to have to wander out of it and understand how anything else works. And so like, I know we like to get in these kind of like shedding conversations or whatever, but like take it from the guy who's got to do a lot of this work. I really don't care, guys, just pick a thing and do it, and I'll tell me how to do it, and I'll do it. Like, I really don't care. So, like, you know, I'm with you, Kent. Like, it offends my taste a little bit to pass callbacks through. But like, in the end, I don't care enough to argue with anybody, and I don't care enough to like want to argue for the interface. You tell me the interface that you want me to use, and I'm just gonna make it work. Like, that's all that's gonna happen. So I think that like these kind of conversations need to happen with the people that like actually
care about that stuff? Like, I know Derek should be here somewhere. No? All right. He's not. Damn it. Well, there goes the IOMAP guy. But, you know, like, I think that it's valuable to have those kind of conversations, but I just want to make it clear from the file system, at least my file system perspective, God, I don't care. Like, I just want it to work, man. Do you tell me what to do? If it looks ugly, I don't give a shit. I didn't have to write it, so it's fine with me.
You know, I love file systems. I've written three. Fortunately, none of them have escaped into the wild, so I don't have to support any of them. But everyone should write a file system or multiple file systems. It's the most fun you can have in programming, which is why I want to make file systems easier to write. And everything I do to the touches the VFS is in terms of how can we make file systems easier to write? Like, what? How can we shrink the interface so that file system authors don't need to learn about all of this complicated stuff? And, you know, I hope I'm succeeding with Folios. I really do. I hope I'm giving you an interface where it's like, okay, unless you're talking about the page fault path, there should be nothing in the file system that cares about pages. I'm just saying, here is a folio, which is a pointer to a bunch of memory. I would like you to fill it with the current data. Or I would like you to, it's dirty, I would like you to get that to disk, please. Like, I'm really trying to make it as easy as possible for file system authors, because I think file systems are awesome.
Yeah, I mean, I can't agree enough with that, what you just said. That was absolutely, as file system guys, our life is miserable anyway with thousands of different weird problems that have nothing to do with memory management. So, like, from my perspective, I would just say, I would love I'll give you an async write interface and a synchronous write if you prefer, you can have both. And I'll tell you my preferred I/O sizes, and I'll give you a clue as, you know, we have to be able to throttle, right? So file system has to know when it needs to throttle back on reads and writes, read ahead, write behind, that kind of thing. So, you know, some measure of, we can have more I/O, we can have less I/O, we need to throttle, we don't need to throttle. Beyond that, I don't care. This is all memory management. So I just, while you were talking, I was grepping migrate page, trying to remind myself what migrate page did. And
maybe you guys should care a little bit more, though, because a lot of, we're in a state where a lot of this. A lot of these core kernel interfaces have kind of like rotted and not changed much over the past 10 years and become really painful for everyone to work on. And they haven't had any clear owner until like Matthew came along and started redoing a lot of this stuff. And maybe if we you know, talked a little bit more about this stuff, like what our pain points are, and took our experiences to figure out, okay, what is the clear model for it? What do we want? Then maybe we could share a little bit more code and have life be a little bit less painful.
Well, I'll toss out my example. I don't know if it's still, I don't know if IOMAP does page at a time internally for copying the pages out of the user's page into the kernel. Like,
it does, yeah.
It does still. So ButterFS not using write begin, write end. That was partially me being like, well, it's stupid to do it a page at a time. They're giving us a bunch of pages. I want to do it on a bunch of pages. And the number of bugs I made in that code was unbelievable, right? It was exceptionally hard to get those specifics right. And so if we're talking about making interfaces that work well with folios, like, that's one thing that you can do to make it much, much better is make some framework for safely, you know, copy from user.
I stole that.
Yeah, it's so bad. It took me so many tries.
Yeah, and thank you, because having the ButterFS idea to work off of, that made my life so much easier. My buffered write path looks basically like yours, and maybe we should, you know, collaborate and promote some of this stuff so that other people aren't falling down the old path and can benefit from our experiences.
Yeah, well, I would love to just pile it into IOMAP. I don't want to be special. I just want not page at a time.
Yeah, and I think, like, you know, to your point, Willie, like, this is a really good point, is there's a lot of this stuff that just isn't owned.
Like, I think it's really great that we have, like, Derek as the biomap maintainer, right? Like, we have to have people that care about this stuff, because I am constantly at the edge of burnout because of the massive amount of things that I gotta keep track of. And, like, adding more and more and more and more and more things that I gotta keep track of is not a recipe for success. And the, you know, I'm so fucking happy that you are doing this, right? Because there's an owner. And, like, you know, we can argue and we can complain and we can, you know, bike shed and stuff, but, like, in the end of the day, it's important to have somebody that actually, like, cares about this code, cares about these interfaces, to make sure that they are well maintained, they're keeping up and keeping track. And that is hard work. Like, it's hard work and it's oftentimes thankless work. So, I mean, thank you, Matthew, because it's not being missed, right? Like, we understand that it's fucking hard and somebody's got to do it. So we're thankful it's you and not us. But this goes, like, to Kent's point, it goes for everything. IOMAP is great. Derek's in charge of that. You get to do all of this. And, like, and this kind of goes for all of these, like, things that we just sit around and kind of do ourselves. We really need to, like, kind of put an effort into the community as far as, like, okay, not only do we need somebody in charge of this, but we need to make sure that, like, they don't hate their lives trying to make this stuff work.
Thank you, Joseph. I really appreciate that, because one of the things I'm conscious of with folios is that I am imposing a cost on all of you. I'm asking you all to learn, to retrain your fingers to no longer type page dirty, but folio test dirty, right? Like, that's a cost, and I'm imposing that on everybody. And I feel the weight of that, and some people have made that point to me, some in more polite ways than others. And so it's really important for me to hear that you feel the cost, but you also see the benefits and that you're willing to pay that cost. So thank you, Joseph. Yeah. Okay, that's my time. Thank you all so much. As you know, I'll be around for the rest of the conference, and I'm sure some of you are going to grab me in the breaks. Thank you.